Good evening, everybody.
Thanks so much for coming.
My name is Randy Gragg, and I'm the director of the John Yeon Center for Architecture and the Landscape. I
gotta get my slide machine here. The John Yeon Center is the steward of two really important historic properties,
the Watzek House, our only National Historic Landmark house, and the Shire, a 78-acre preserve in the Columbia Gorge, both designed by John Yeon. Please come visit. If you're not on our mailing list, there's opportunities to get on it, so take advantage of it. We also do programs such as tonight and our next program. Our programs are usually about the history of the city or the future of the city.
The next one is Monday, November 7th, and it'll be about Portland's design review, the state of design review in the city, with Mark Hinshaw, who's been a consultant to the city. And then next May, we're going to be upstairs and over there
with a retrospective of John Yeon, his landscape and his architecture and his collection of European and Asian decorative arts. It's going to be a spectacular show. We're taking over most of the ground floor of the museum, so we hope to see you then. I want to thank a few folks. First off, our co-presenter tonight, Pioneer Courthouse Square, and Ashley Brittner and Jen Pulver and their team, who has, among other things, got you all here and helped us produce this great event. I also want to thank our venue, Portland Art Museum, and the Associate Director of Education, Stephanie Parrish, who has helped me put on so many great events in this venue, in this wonderful room. So let's see here. One other thing. I want to give a shout out to Oregon Historical Society and to invite you to a reception afterwards across the park. We'll have some food and some drink and some toasts maybe and a few other things. So please come over. So tonight is a pretty special evening. Doug Macy, of course, all of you know, and we thought that it would be a great opportunity to spend some time with him. I like to say that there's no architect who has had a larger, wider impact on Oregon than John Yeon, but Doug has had, as I'm learning, an equally broad and important impact. And if you think maybe of Oregon as a work of art, John Yeon might have laid down the underpainting. So a lot of the early preservation work, a lot of the thinking about parks. So just kind of these layers of color people like Doug have come in and with the small brushes and brought in the details. And it's very, very few, I don't think any architect who's touched more corners of Oregon than Doug. Some of you may know him from way back in the room. I think we can see that he really hasn't changed a whole lot. But to give you a sense of the scope of his work, the Columbia Gorge Discovery Center, the Oregon Vietnam Memorial, the State Capitol Mall, the High Desert Museum, Opal Creek, Oregon Shakespeare Festival, the Tillamook Forestry Center, Oregon State University campus, and even something like that, I'm going to totally butcher the pronunciation of this, so I apologize, the Nikyawi Warriors Memorial on the Umatilla Indian Reservation. So this is to say nothing of his rather extensive nonprofit and pro bono work across the state, which most recently has played such a profound role in the creation of the addition of the Japanese Garden with Kengo Kuma. But like a lot of people in this room, you know, Doug's deepest engagement has really been with the city, with Portland. And he and his firm, Walker Macy, have probably touched more of downtown than any other firm. Doug likes to spread the gospel, and often has to other cities, talking about the city's parks and our kind of urban DNA. And so we thought it'd be great to adapt the talk into a conversation and kind of an oral history to share with you tonight. And so please join me in welcoming Doug Macy.
That's true.
Sir?
Over here?
Yeah. Do you want the slide?
What's that?
That's the slide projector there, just the green button.
I'll learn as we go.
Okay. Or I can do it, and you can just tell me when you want to switch.
Well, as Randy said, I've been interested in the development of public open space in Portland my entire career. It really started in earnest when we were doing Pioneer Courthouse Square design competition with the late Will Martin as my collaborator on that project, where we ask ourselves, you know, okay, what do we have? And so, you know, somebody's asking us what we should do, and the challenge is, which I'll get into later, we're a new space in downtown Portland. So what do we have already that we don't want to repeat? So that kind of led to the some of my early explorations about that. And that went on through my entire career and continues today. So how do I advance this?
So we can look there and you can talk.
So you can advance it?
Uh-huh.
That's great. So I just,
that's what I'm here for.
I just got rid of some responsibility that I didn't want, which is what I have done that all my life as well. Part of my success is the fact that I've worked with a great firm and developed a great firm with great people over the years, and I've really enjoyed the work we've done here and throughout the Western United States primarily. And so we're going to start back when, as far as I can tell, the first park era is in 1860 to 1960. So here's a print of downtown Portland. So it shows the park blocks, north and south park blocks, and it's kind of mushy how it terminates to the right. But and then along with that is the Lonsdale and Chapman Square. These two spaces were platted I'm not a historian, and so I can't speak to how they got platted or what that. That's another story that I'd love to add to this. You can see the landscape was very rough, and it had been logged, and there was kind of a rural landscape to the west. Downtown was an active, vibrant, and harbor. It's where our entire harbor was located at the time. You can see there's no bridges. There were ferries at that time. Next. So here's what that park block looked like in 1880. So we go from 1860 to 1880. 20 years later, you can see that the city is developing as a much more a broad city that's moving to the west. And it's just, you know, to me, remarkable that this was done at this time in the city, in this little western city. Go to the next one. And what has become today with the South Park blocks and the North Park blocks, the two of the most iconic public spaces in our city, which we have renovated and changed over the years, and the next couple shots show what that is. And that's, you know, basically the home of this building. It's the cultural campus of Portland, where the Art Museum, the Historic Society, there were many churches in this area. But basically has become a really wonderful public space that extends from PSU to the south all the way into the core, sort of jumping over and going up to the North Park blocks. Lonsdale Square is a slightly different. Lonsdale Square represents a more of the civic area where the federal courthouse, the city hall, the public buildings of the time were built around this very, very quiet and very, very green sort of landscape. So we now at this point we have these, as far as parks are concerned, we have very soft, green, traditional park spaces. So in the 1960s, this is kind of what the urban renewal area looked like. Go to next. So this is probably the major major event in the downtown development of a downtown. This is what was called the South. Most people don't even know it as this today, but it's the South Auditorium Project. Project, which is where major neighborhoods, ethnic neighborhoods, were taken down, and a plan was developed by Skidmore, Owings & Merrill and Lawrence Halprin. Go to the next one. To develop a concept for how this would become a pedestrian series of housing developments and mixed use developments, office buildings, etc., connected by a pedestrian way that connects through a series of pedestrian zones. Unlike today, where we would do this in terms of expanding our street grid and respecting our street grid, this was a time and not a very good time in the sense that it's been, because this is a very difficult area. But it's a very, very quiet, very pedestrian area that links from the south to the north. And Lawrence Halprin, this is part of the Halprin sequence. Lawrence Halprin was hired to, as part of this design team, to develop this plan, starting at the Lovejoy Park in the south. Moving to the Pettigrew Park, which is a more contemporary park, then moving to the Keller Fountain, which is a civic park associated with our
That's civic opening auditorium.
So this became, again, one of the iconic spaces that existed in the 1970s when we were doing the Pioneer Courthouse Square.
I'm curious, Doug, if I can just interrupt for just a moment. So as a landscape architect, where were you in your career in these years?
I moved here in 1970.
Okay, so just as this was opening.
This was just opening when I moved here. So a lot of these things I saw at the beginning, I saw a lot of these things as they evolved and as the city changed its ordinances and standards to make a better downtown area.
So this must have been pretty exciting for a young landscape architect to see something like this.
Well, yeah, we worked at the office I was in at the time, the office of Robert Perrin. We worked on the South Auditorium project. So it was the first project I did when I moved to Portland, was to work in this district.
And did you spend time with Larry Halprin when he was?
I met Larry, but he was basically had become so well so renowned. He was all over the. This sort of launched him into a lot of projects. So he wasn't around much. Byron McCulley was a guy that worked for him that had gone to Harvard with Bob Perrin, and they knew each other, and so that's how we had that association. So we essentially helped them take the design and develop the design and implement this series of pedestrian ways and the parks.
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of when I come into the scene as a young landscape architect. And City of Portland was really This was the first development of public open space, and I point to it because people come from all over the world to see this park. So it represents what Halpern did here, represents a new idea about parks that certainly didn't exist until that time.
Yeah, it sort of seemed like the inmates got the keys to the asylum or something. With this, I mean, Larry Halpern contracted directly with the city as opposed to being underneath.
That's right.
An architect, so it was a kind of a interesting turning point for landscape architecture.
Yeah, that was Ira Killer that had to do with that, I think, wasn't it?
He did. Yeah, he did.
Yeah.
But it must have been a pretty signature moment for somebody coming out just out of school to come to the city, and they're doing parks like this.
Well, yeah, and you can see we're moving into an era where you can see other things that are happening that in the 70s. So let's go to the next slide. This is the downtown plan. The downtown plan was developed by some very, very creative planners. And young urban planners and architects and people that were working for the city and people that were consulting with us for the city. And out of that, all these little dots you see on here and open spaces that represent a whole series of projects, of which in the center of, in terms of the core of our city, was Pioneer Square. And it was considered to be one of the most important spaces to be developed.
So it was set out as a goal, you're saying. And then
it was really a focus of that. It was like, we need to have a plaza, a public plaza here, not another park. So we had to give that some thought. During this period of time, other things that came out of the plan were the street tree ordinance. When I came to town, this is what the streets in downtown Portland all looked like. This, they had absolutely no trees. So this is the same photograph taken from the same location. It's showing what the effects of just the visual effects of the impact of vegetation and essentially parkways, et cetera, on our downtown. The other thing this is a hallmark of Larry Halpern, again, working as a consultant on the first transit wall. Street trees were a major part of that plan that was developed. The other thing that was a problem at the time was the fact that we had all these blank walls. Now, not as many as other cities, but the blank wall, as illustrated by O'Brien Square and the expansion of Chapman Square, and buildings
originally First National Bank building. Now it's Wells Fargo.
What is it?
Wells Fargo now.
Wells Fargo Bank.
Yeah.
It's been in the news recently. Glad I'm not a banker. But these are horrible buildings. I mean, just to my humble opinion, these are buildings that had no relationship to the street. The street had no relationship to the building. They were just... And everybody recognized that, and everybody recognized in other cities in the Western United States that this is a problem. You go to San Diego today, and during this same era and slightly after it, there's block after block after block of buildings with these big ramps running down to parking garages. So today we have an ordinance. The ordinance basically plays out, and I use this example because this is not a this is a building that was built very recently, a contemporary building. There's nothing fancy about the street, or it's not on a parkway. But the fact is, you look at it, it's got almost the entire ground floor, with the exception of getting into the parking garage, is open to the public, is visible. It's, you see it, it's a sandwich shop. You see it, it, what it is. And so it communicates very well in that respect. So in 1964, another important thing that was going on, this is a lot of people don't understand that in 1964, what is now NATO Parkway was an interstate. It was,
Harbor Drive,
but it was actually, this was part of the interstate transportation system. This is predating the advent of freeways in the downtown. So go to the next slide, 1968, you can see there were absolutely no trees at all in the last one, but it was, but trees had been planted, and these trees were the beginning of what is the set of trees that you see today, and what makes our park. So converting this highway in our downtown to a major parkway, essentially a series of parks within a park, was really one of the major developments of open space that I think has had a positive effect on the quality of life in the downtown. It starts with the North Park blocks. This is not in historic sequence, but to the north, up by the steel bridge, between the steel bridge and the Burnside Bridge, you have the cherry trees, which have now, this is an old photograph, but the cherry trees that have developed into a really, that were a gift from Japanese wheat traders that created this kind of identity for this relatively small section of the park, going next to the to going further north to the core area, and what has recently been developed as Ankeny Plaza, and where the home of the 30-some-year-old Saturday Market, which has been it's been around for
both of these sections, by the way, designed by you and Walker Macy.
What's that?
Both of these sections designed by you and Walker Macy.
Yeah,
by
uh-huh. Ankeny Plaza and the North Park blocks were developed by. We designed those for parks. Again, the central part of the park, and for years the major, but before Ankeny Plaza and before North Park, this was what we did. This was a place we celebrated. The central greensward of the downtown waterfront was a major place for big events and carnivals, and it has evolved to today to all kinds of fun runs and food events and beer events and more beer events and some more beer events, and so it remains a major destination, actually regional destination in the downtown. So after that was the South Waterfront. Let's go to the move to the South Waterfront. So this was in the 1980s. The River Place was being developed, which was you could see that the Markham Bridge has been developed and that's replaced the regional transportation system, moving it off of the waterfront to allow all that waterfront to happen. The other thing that's important about South Waterfront, go to the next slide, it was the development of the next phase of the major public open space. That did two things in my mind. One is it created a area that did not have a seawall. So all the rest of the waterfront was a seawall system. That was all about the floods that happened prior to the development of the dams and the Cascades. So what was allowed here, it was the idea of a performance space that were sloped down to the water. So that was one of the significant things that grew out of this. The second one is it was the first time that we had residential directly on the waterfront. And Harriet Sherburn's here, and she had an awful lot to do with the development of that whole part of the public-private partnership that came out of the. So that's River Place today. Shortly thereafter, in 1999, it was pretty clear that as the density grew in this area, there was a need for a place for people to have, like a backyard. People are moving in from the west hills. They're moving in from other places. They're downsizing their homes, and so they need a place. They need their own a garden or something to replace their garden. So. When Zuri Sontner was the director of parks, she was instrumental in getting this first of the a perennial garden, essentially, as a park. The first garden of its any kind built as part of a park system since way before parks like in Forest Park. So that's
that is also designed by Walker Macy.
Yes,
by the way.
Yes. I was telling somebody this is not about me. It really, you know, I've been very fortunate to be able to work on these projects, and I think as in looking at them at with some little bit of long on the tooth point of view. I understand how important they are. They're really important to what our city is, has been, and how we've developed it. So that garden exists today as a great little respite, essentially, in a very active waterfront. So the shipyards, again, a lot of people don't know about the shipyards, but this ideal area, this is in the what we call the South Waterfront District. It's where the ships were dismantled. I recall when I first came here, huge piles of steel being taken out of these ships and being repurposed and taken away and repurposed for other things. So. That then it transitioned in the 2000 and early 2000 to a mixed industrial area, and then long story short, a lot of planning to develop a new residential neighborhood in the south. What's the South Waterfront Greenway? I think is the best way to. Describe it. So there's so many South parks. So the Crothers Park was a neighborhood park, which is fully developed now, it really provides a great. I was down there this last weekend, and it's just even on a brisk day, just a really great little park with a playground and sort of passive in its own way. On the waterfront, more importantly, so it's Carruthers Park. The waterfront was an interesting development because this is a master plan that was done as part of all the South Waterfront Greenway, where all the condominiums and more recently mixed-use housing. But this was a portion of the park for the first time that was really, we went from the seawall to no seawall to the, I didn't mention it, but in the South Waterfront Garden to a sort of a even more greening of the water, of the direct water and the relationship of the upland to the water. This was a very, very innovative system of supporting this that was done with all the biologists and ologists of all kinds that were involved in this project with my partner, Mike Zilas, who has led this, along with Chelsea McCann from the office, who eventually implemented this plan. A very innovative approach to waterfront development. Being used, by the way, as an example, many other cities already being studied. So let's go to Pioneer Square. So again, Pioneer Square had been identified going clear back into the 60s as an important space in the downtown. If you look at this photograph, it's important to look at this photograph and look at the numbers of surface parking lots right in the downtown. Now, some of these are parking garages, or some of these are parking within buildings, but the downtown was really a surface parking environment, including the Pioneer Square block that we're going to get into here.
So, just for orientation, Pioneer Courthouse, or there was Pioneer Courthouse, and there was this parking lot.
So just a little walk down memory lane for those people that go back to 1840s. actually, there was, if I'm not mistaken, there was a school before this school. Then there was a schoolhouse in 1840. And in 1860, the Portland Hotel was just a masterpiece of sort of social and architectural sort of statement in the core of our downtown. And at this point, a very positive building and a very positive contribution to the surrounding city. Going forward, however, that was torn down, and a surface parking lot deck that came in off of Broadway and created this sort of, you can see, talk about blank wall. No street trees here, a blank wall, worse than a blank wall, sort of a cavern effect and a parking deck. This is a model that Randy
this actually was what was proposed for that lot by Meyer and Frank, which was a 12-story parking, full block parking garage that the Planning Commission, actually before the 72 downtown plan, the Planning Commission, and if anybody has something to add to this or to correct me on it, I believe it was in 1967, considered this proposal. Rod Oheiser, who was hoping to see tonight, but I don't think is here, built this model to illustrate the impact that it would have on downtown, and the Planning Commission voted it down and called for a public square in its place.
Yeah.
And that was well before the 72 town plan, but that's kind of when it started to get lodged in.
Well, there was a lot of talk about it
before
the downtown plan, and then Rod was kind of a These are other plans that were developed, and I was just talking to Bob Frasca a little bit earlier, that he did a plan here, and I had a picture of it, but it was kind of weird, and the design, as I was telling Bob, I thought was brilliant. It was like this big Tory gate. It was really classic.
Yeah, I've seen that. Yeah.
But I found this image of it, but it didn't work in this show. So
there's another one.
And these are other examples of proposals were being made. So all these people were making all these proposals. Why don't you do this? Why don't you do that? Is there one?
What I always heard was that every time Neil Goldschmidt would go to Washington for money, he would call up a different architect and have him draw a plan that he thought would please whoever it was that he was meeting with. And so that there's this whole legacy of Pioneer Courthouse square plans that are the result
another story that I hadn't heard. So. Or I vaguely remember it now that you mention it. But there's so many stories out there, including the great the great proposal to make it into an atrium, charge a fee to get in and have it as a sort of an entertainment place and food and for those people who were worthy. unlike all of us that are not worthy.
That was Bill Robertson, correct, who was really pushing for this plan?
Was it Bill?
Yeah. That's what I thought. It was kind of the business community was really pushing for
this. Yeah, it was the business community approach. So.
Yeah.
Randy's going to take...
So there was this competition, which Doug's going to talk about his proposal for, but I apologize for the blurriness of the slide, but just so you know that Larry Halperin didn't walk on water, this was his proposal for Pioneer Courthouse Square with Charles Moore. They teamed
there
up.
I think there were other influences here.
And then there was Peter Eisenman, who the architects in the audience will know, who also it was quite young in his early in his career that he proposed this. And this was Machado Silvetti. So these are the Pioneer Courthouse squares that might have been that were all entered into this competition. But the story of the competition, let's talk about that for a little bit, because you said the competition kind of grew out of the local architects having done all these proposals and everybody kind of angling for the job.
Well, everybody had a desire to do something. And so it's my understanding that led to, in part, to having a design competition to call attention and bring to, call attention to this as an important public space in an important growing city. So the design competition was led by Don Stastny, who's to the right of this photograph. I'm on the left back when I had a dark beard. And that's Friedberg, what's his name?
Paul Friedberg.
Paul Friedberg, who mm-hmm. is the design advisor to the selection committee, and other members. So this is a selected design that we won this in a two-step process. First, we had to submit a proposal, and that's another story. But this proposal we submitted was a little glass box. It was designed by one of the design team members, which is there were five or six of us on the design team. Oh, and that's another story we can talk about if anybody wants to know about that. So this is the design that we won with. And the next drawing, the next slide is a drawing by the late Will Martin of our proposal at the time.
So it was Will Martin, yourself, Lee Kelly, Terrence O'Donnell,
the historian from the Historic Society,
right,
Spencer Gill, who's a writer, and Rob Reynolds, who was a book publisher and really great photographer. Actually, his son's still a photographer. Is a photographer. The idea of our putting together this team was to. We knew we were going to be up against all these formidable architects from all over the country, and if not the world. So, how do we make the shortlist even? So we had this kind of understatement. Everybody else submitted the book, the big book with the plastic binder and everything. We just submitted this precious little thing, which sort of got handed around and treated like, and the point we were making was, come on, give some local boys and girls a chance. And it worked. Somebody bought it. I don't know. The jury bought it. And so it was a pretty interesting story how we got to that. So this is a series. This is another thing that we did. This is one of those events where we painted on the the parking lot was going to be demolished, and there was going to be a park here. But it was still a deck, but the cars had been removed. And so we had this idea. It was sitting there as a blank sheet of just a blank canvas in the city. And so we got this idea whose idea it was. It's one of the design team. Or it could have probably somebody like Terrence O'Donnell. I can't recall. But let's paint. Let's show people what this thing's going to look like.
So now, at this point, this wasn't a done deal. The money hadn't been raised, and
yeah, but it's only 3 years before the
yeah.
Thing was
but
built.
Wasn't there still some opposition to it? On
oh
the part?
My God, there was major opposition. That was where the selling of the bricks happened.
Yeah, yeah, but I mean, the painting was kind of a almost like an agitprop effort to kind of further sell this to the public, right?
Oh, no, we did this to call attention.
Yeah,
to this.
Yeah.
And, the police helped us get off the street, make sure we were all safe, thinking this was some sort of a legitimate social, deal. And it was totally, we just...
This was guerrilla? Totally guerrilla?
Huh?
It was totally a guerrilla project?
It was totally guerrilla. We got the paint was donated by Miller Paint and so, Miller.
Yeah. So by the way, I want to call out that these beautiful photographs are by Bruce Forster, who's in the crowd tonight, and just incredible documentation of this totally guerrilla event. You guys just did this, huh?
Well, these were good photographs when they were taken, but he has digitized these, and they're fabulous documents. So here we are. I'm down there somewhere, and my son is there. My son was he was a second grader or something like that, and he was helping out. Other people's kids came, and it was totally guerrilla.
I was wondering what the story was behind that car sitting in the middle of it.
What's that about?
I was always, whose car was that?
I think somebody found that car. It was gorilla. So I think somebody brought that car in because it wasn't. But Bill Fletcher, not Bill, but Kurt Finch, architect Kurt Finch, some of you knew him, spent 2 days projecting the square, the design of the square, over the top of this car and over the top of the facility.
Oh, the gas station, yeah.
Yeah, it hasn't been painted there yet.
Yeah.
It was the ticket get place. So this was all designed to call attention to the, and it just absolutely, totally infuriated Mayor Ivan C.
who was leading the opposition. He was leading the opposition.
Yeah,
to
and,
it.
Yeah. And Bill, yeah, Bill Roberts.
Yeah.
Who, was prominent downtown property owner.
It's one of the great moments in Portland history, to my mind. It's like. There it is.
It was fun to be involved in. That's Will's car out there. We hauled all the paint. He was famous for his pickup truck, 3/4-ton truck. So then it was under construction in '82 and '80. This is the again. I show this photograph because the bricks had become an important part of fundraising. We didn't raise hardly any money really. In the original sales, but what it did is it raised support, and it got people involved. So the more bricks you had names on, the more owners you had of the place. It's kind of like fundraising today. You got to develop your friends first, and then once you've developed a relationship with somebody, then you can ask them for money. So in this case, okay.
Oops.
That was the strategy there. So this is the dedication in 1984, and it was a great day. So Pioneer Square, after all this effort over the years that it became an important 1 acre heart of our downtown. And this presentation, as I've given it to other different people from that aren't from here, next slide, we'll talk about the fact that it's not just the parks and the public spaces that we create, it's the associated streets. So you think of this, you had to first add to the transit mall, which was an enhanced pedestrian way, as the light rail was developed, you had both those streets were enhanced pedestrian environments in conjunction with, I think Neil had something to do with this, money for transit and build a great street. So that just shows what you can do and how important it is to think about this, how the quality of the street as public open space. Because if you think about, if you walk around a city, how much of it is park and how much of it is a street? A lot of it's a street. There's just a lot of streets in our city that make up the quality of our space. And our 200-foot block grid is really part of that that makes Portland really what it is. Most cities have much larger block grids. And so, again, we celebrate that, both in terms of development of our public space and our streets. So today, Pioneer Square, and I just won't go into all the facts, but you know, millions of people a year with a full management team of people, a budget of, I can't recall the numbers, but a huge support in terms of financial support from sponsors that allow and pay for a wide range of events from the Festival of Flowers to next Farmers Markets. Major event is the tree lighting ceremony is a big deal, and just a noon concert. A very common kind of things that happen that maybe only 400 or 500 people come to, but they're important. They're important to the city, and they fulfill the dream that the design team had, that this would be a place that would be designed to serve a wide range of people, and from large events, important events to day-to-day sort of smaller events.
So there's two questions I want to ask you about Pioneer Courthouse Square. So looking back, what do you think sustained the political energy to build this? Because there was considerable opposition to it throughout its entire development.
Well, part of it had to do with getting Nordstrom's to the downtown, because Meyer and Frank was iffy. And in order to appease the people that were more interested in parking, developing the Morrison Park East and West were very important.
The garages.
So there was that was a deal that was cut that getting Nordstrom to the downtown, getting the parking moved out, sort of freed this up so that parking still existed in the downtown, but it just wasn't here.
Mm-hmm.
So, and there was, meanwhile, a lot of the downtown was beginning to all these parking lots that you saw, the one of the photographs, they were going away and they were being replaced with buildings with parking garages, et cetera.
So has there been anything that has been surprising to you about how Pioneer Courthouse Square has been used? I mean, you guys conceived this design, but what is there anything unanticipated that came out of it? Things you've had to change?
Well, the whole thing. We didn't know that this was going to work. We did things like we built in the place, the mast, the sleeve to put the Christmas tree. Well, we didn't know whether they'd have anybody would do a Christmas tree, but we thought, well, let's put a Christmas, you know, and maybe somebody will put a tree in it. And the same thing with the fundamental design. Let's create this amphitheater type space. Thinking, well, if we lay things out and we keep the center clear of any, don't encumber the design, and to keep a big space, about three quarters of the space is open. The rest of it's got steps and little amphitheaters and vendors, etc. But so that was something we thought. Well, that might play well, but we had no idea that it was going to take off. And I think part of why it took off was that City hired Roger Shields to go around the country and see whether there were other spaces that were managed. And what he learned was, no, there was no place that was managed. And we had come up as a design team with the idea that there would be this sort of mayor, I think Will called it the mayor of the square. And there would be a person that would sort of see to it that everything was okay and sort of day to day. Well, that sort of morphed into management. And so there was actually a very early management structure, very primitive compared to what we have today in terms of how the square is managed. I mean, you're talking about millions of dollars of a sponsorship and operational functions today. It was quite a surprise to us that it was successful. Our goal was, okay, just design it so, and that was part of the food service idea, is that make sure you have some food service there. Food and beverage was, we thought, what might be a one way, because we'd seen that and there were some other examples in the country.
Mm-hmm.
Where that was probably the most important part of it, is to have a place to go get a cup of coffee. So there were a lot of influences, but the whole thing was, to us, quite surprising and in a very happy way. Where I think if we all got together, the Bowser, what was called the Bowsers, we all got together today, we'd
pat yourselves on the back.
No, we don't. It'd be a party, you know.
So
okay, so we're taking a long time here. So another important area of town, this again, much like the extension of our urban areas to the South Waterfront, the Pearl District has more recently replaced the rail yards.
I just want to orient everybody. There's the train station, Broadway Bridge, and the viaduct that used to cut through the district.
Yeah, I have a slide to orient you here, but let's just talk about the important things.
Okay.
My great slide to orient you is of EcoTrust, which is still there today. So what was going on there, and I was living about six blocks away across the freeway that had been just being built. And important thing is that the viaduct, the Broadway viaduct, can you point to that, Randy?
Mm-hmm.
That was an elevated street, and it was just, you know, it was a terrible place for people. I mean, this was not a very happy place to be. So all of that came down, and that became a street, and then the planning people involved in the planning of this then decided to superimpose the 200-foot block grid and kind of a variations of it over this neighborhood as a way to essentially having public open space create value to development and vice versa. Development supporting public open space. So Peter Walker was hired along with others to develop the plan for the Pearl District. And so what basically starting at Jamison Square to the south, we're going to now move, we've gone from the north to the south, and now we're going to go from the south to the north. Jamison Square, which was the first park built on the lower right, was the first park developed. And this is the big
boardwalk connecting them.
Boardwalk that connects this all the way to the waterfront. So it's a series of spaces that I think are quite successful, some more successful than others. but the idea is to have an active kind of a children's related water feature. The dry saddle park being more of a contemporary park. And then the fields to the north being a larger kind of play field, more open place to throw frisbee and run your dog, etc. There's something going on in this photograph here. I don't know what. So that's a development strategy that obviously that if you judge it by how successful the Pearl District is as a development and as a place to go for parks, it's a very successful strategy of how open space can contributes to our city.
Well, it's also, I think it's important to point out that it also was part of the deal that the city made with the developers, because basically there was three major tenants. The developers could have built townhouses here. Extremely low density.
Yeah.
And Homer Williams, one of the key developers, would tell you today that he would have made more money had he done that because of the speed in which you could turn it over.
Yeah.
But if the city took down the Lovejoy ramp, they would build to a certain higher density. If they built the streetcar, they would build to an even higher density. And if they built the three parks, I may not have the order correct, they would build it to an even higher density. And so it was basically this handshake in which parks were a major part of the urbanization of
that
area.
Right.
Yeah. So it's interesting in terms of the level of sophistication the use of urban renewal in that area.
Right.
Compared to, say, at the start of urban renewal, which was the Halpern blocks, and
that's a good way to bracket it, because that was kind of urban renewal, and this was a form of urban renewal that had become much more sophisticated in terms of the qualities of both development and open space that grew out of it.
It's also interesting that we sort of have this collection of parks as a result.
Yeah.
By some leading landscape architects from around the world.
Yeah, that absolutely.
Really begins with Halpern and also plenty of locals in there. And have you been to a city in which there's been such a collection of different...
No.
Yeah. Yeah, this is one of the most sort of architecturally distinguishing features about Portland.
No, I think if somebody were to try to find a city that had the widest range of landscape architects that had an influence and designed a public space, plaza, park, whatever, Portland's right. It's got to be top of the heap. I mean, it's really a result of a commitment by the Parks Department. Zeri Sautner and specifics, but before that, to make sure that we diversified the voice that we had in terms of development of our parks. And that's, to me, that's one of the most interesting things about living here and working here, is that you get to see other people's work in your neighborhood. I mean, I walk 10 minutes and I'm in Jamison Square. I walk north and I'm in Greenworks and Drysdale's Tanner Springs. If I go a little further, it's really a very diverse set of voices that have created what we have today.
So you have some closing slides here that you wanted to...
Yeah, just both through the... So this is kind of, okay, I've taken you through this. I've done many versions of this for many people. This is the first time I've given it to an all-Portland crowd, usually at some university or some city in Australia or some Japan or someplace. So I'm glad to be giving this talk to the folks, to many folks that I know. So here's the kind of the set of, I'm not going to go into any great detail on this, but this is kind of open spaces in 1985. Done a lot of work up until that point, and then the light rail had came in. That was part of this network of open spaces that came, pedestrian spaces that came with transit. That was extended on to the west, and then we got the, I think very important, as you point out, Randy, the streetcar and how it connects Northwest Portland Good Samaritan Hospital all the way through the downtown, intersects with the light rail and eventually out to the south. Then in the future, this slide's kind of left over from something else, but because the fields have been done, and for some reason in this particular slideshow, Tanner Springs and the fields.
What happened to Centennial
Jameson
Mill?
But it's close. What this is suggesting is that two major opportunities in our city, is the waterfront development connecting the Pearl District with the waterfront, and the extension of in some form, whether it's a continuous park block or not. But a series of spaces that would come through the post office building, which we've been trying to get rid of for years and years, and so. But it's getting much closer, and so there's active thinking about this. Many people are working on this within the city, and also consultants that are working on. On the development strategy, going from the Broadway sort of what used to be the Broadway viaduct next to the rail, the regional rail system, extending back to the past PNCA to the North Park blocks. So that's kind of my take on what, in some respect, what I've learned and what I've come to know as a set of circumstances that have led to what I think is a great place to live and a great place to create a set of parks. Andy.
So taking that sort of future idea even farther. Now, you've worked on different sections of Waterfront Park, essentially a whole series of pieces, except for this main central area. And I'm wondering what your thinking is about this central area. I mean, it was really conceived as a linear park. I don't think, looking back in the documents, that it was ever conceived for the kind of level of and number of events that happened there each year. It was really thought of as a linear park. Do you think that this part of the waterfront park needs to be rethought in any way, or do you think it's functioning well?
It serves so many different functions: social, entertainment, promotional, nonprofit activities. That I don't think we want to wreck that. I mean, just because it's kind of dull and it's geese all over the place, and the place gets completely torn up every year and it has to be completely reconstructed. I think you have to be very careful what you do as going forward. I think it would be interesting to add to that zone of the park a component of additional ways to get out over the water. And I think that was actually a recommendation in kind of an extravagant and probably not very practical way, part of one of the last plans.
Master plans,
done.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I can't remember who did that plan, but so I think studying the edge,
mm-hmm.
Are there ways to make the edge better? Is important. It's another really difficult issue that has to do with the relationship of this park to NATO Parkway to development in that area. That's a real abyss in there. I mean, to get from my office on First and Oak, you've got to run the gauntlet across the NATO Parkway, and it's really not the most positive redevelopment area there. Now, the farmers market is planned to go in there. There's some things like that I think would energize that, but I think it's important that we continue to be very careful about how we think about that central space as sort of the great stage of Portland for mm-hmm. all this food and beer and beer and
yeah,
beer.
So flexibility, beer and beer and beer.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's become that. You know, it's like But no, those are important things. Those are important. I mean, as much as I get irritated trying to go to the office on Saturday. Well, during a fundraiser, there was a marathon or something, and it took me forever to get to the. I had to drive clear to the center of the city and come back to get to my office.
So I want to ask you another question, then we're going to open it up to some audience questions. So our mobile microphones, please get ready. About the Central East Side and the Inner East Side, there's been a lot of attention paid by the current Parks Commissioner to the Outer East Portland and the parks deficit out there, and rightly so, is not very much. But there's incredible density coming to the Inner East Side, and there really are no parks, and there's certainly not any new parks planned. And what we've seen arise, the closest thing to what one might call green spaces, are a number of bioswales, some of which are more elaborate than other bioswales, but it sort of seems like that's the main strategy. And I'm wondering, with your years of experience looking at a place that is urbanizing so quickly, what would be your recipe for bringing a little of the park's love that we have on the west side of downtown to what is essentially going to become the east side of downtown?
Well, I think a lot of it has to do with the lessons we learned in the Pearl. The Pearl, somebody paying attention to, and I don't know who would take the lead on this, but much like the Pearl, where you have a potential for a lot of development. So that development, as you point out, is happening. Is the open space commensurate with that? Much like in the Pearl, is there a strategy? I don't think there is for the close-in east side. So the idea of as the demand, you can't build a bunch of parks and they're not associated with housing. I mean, there needs to be housing as part of that mix. But I think there needs to be a plan that develops a long-term strategy for how to proceed with making a park system as part of that whole neighborhood. There's the what's it called, the Green Loop?
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's part of what you're talking about.
Could be, yeah. That could be one part of the recipe.
And that could be one, you know. But the Green Loop. You don't want to create a loop to nowhere. But to have as development happens through that entire district, you go down there today and there's all kinds of, again, parking lots and development potential just abounds. So how do we balance the development, living and work and recreation?
Our recipe in downtown has been single block parks, and we don't own any land over there. The public doesn't own any land. And I'm wondering, you've traveled around. I mean, Seattle, you were working on a project that was essentially a vacation of a street, correct? The Vine Street? Is that not part of something you were working on? It was actually a green street that was pedestrianized? Okay, I'm mixing it up then. Let's go on to
If it is, it's my Seattle office. Okay.
Thought I remember talking about it one time. Questions from the audience. Anybody got anything out there? Yeah. If you wouldn't mind waiting for the microphone so we can record.
What's your thought on the development of the Markham Bridge back in the 50s when they proposed to go straight down the waterfront? If they could have taken it back to like Union Avenue, they would have made it. That whole waterfront on the east side and ran it all the way down Union Avenue, the I-5 corridor, set up right on the waterfront. You could have done that whole east side. Had another downtown area on the east side instead of a freeway on the water. Do you understand what I'm saying?
I don't understand the question.
Well, let me reframe the question, because it was funny, actually, on a Facebook post today, somebody was dissing something I wrote as not being thinking big enough and brought up the idea of moving the freeway again.
Oh, again,
Do you think that there's any merit or hope for moving I-5?
That's a big project. It's kind of like the big dig in Seattle.
In Boston, you mean? Oh, well, yeah, Seattle, too, yeah. Yeah.
But Boston, I use Seattle because it's happening and the drill machine
kind of
breaks
not
down
happening
all the
at time,
and I hear about it more. So it's a major public work project. It's huge, and, yeah, I think it's worth doing. I don't have, and I have not thought about, how that would happen, but it's one of those projects. It's got millions and millions of dollars worth of studying in terms of how you get ramps on and ramps off, and it's a mess now. You couldn't make I-5, I-84, you couldn't make it any worse. So there's got to be a better way to solve that whole cluster that happens. It's one of the most irritating places in Portland. When I come in from the airport, I say, "Oh no, am I just going to get on Sandy? I'm going to the north. I'm going to my
oh, driving in Portland." Another question. In the back. Way back there.
So given that Portland's facing a lot of gentrification, how do you create spaces and parks that are welcoming to people from all sorts of different socioeconomic statuses, especially even taking into some consideration the homeless population?
I didn't hear it.
Okay. She was asking, how can we make public spaces for a greater diversity of the population, particularly homeless people, since they're such a part of our fabric these days?
Yeah. Our homeless problem, I never thought I would live to see such a problem. I couldn't anticipate something, a social problem that has to do with facilities and making public improvements. I simply cannot and have not gotten my head around that. But there has to be a positive way to integrate. I think the best way to deal with homeless is to find a way to create sort of communities within our communities, but in a way that's acceptable to the surroundings. And so that's a really interesting question of how that gets done. And it'd be something really interesting to take on. But you have to understand, and I don't, social services, mental health issues, things like there's a whole set of circumstances around the homeless population that I just closest as I've gotten to dealing with that is people having done the state the psychiatric hospital in Salem is these are people that have been taken off the streets and have been they're being dealt with in an institutional format, and which is very positive at one level, but they're not part of the community at all. So that's my level of experience there, and it's a tough issue. I've actually been thinking about it a lot because it's something I just can't get my head around.
I mean, imagining that you were just out of college, you know, an ambitious landscape architect, is that a problem you can imagine yourself wanting to kind of take on in some manner? Do you think there's a role for landscape architects and designers in
this?
Oh,
I think it's a multidisciplinary, just like many, many things that we do, it has to be a multidisciplinary thing. But it has to include healthcare, mental health, and it has to deal with sort of the social life of a homeless person and how to identify what is needed to get from a negative homeless situation to a situation where people can live in a comfortable relationship with their surroundings. And I think that would be a fascinating problem, but it's going to take architects and landscape architects and social services, and mental health. It would be a really fascinating. In fact, it would be a fascinating thing for people, as you say, young professionals. But I think it needs to be not done by. It's not a design solution that's necessary. It's an understanding what you're dealing with, and then having the design grow out of that, which is really really the way we have done many things.
Other question? I saw another. Yes.
On a much more mundane level, the Pioneer Courthouse Square. There are two things that I was curious about. One was, did you know that? I'll ask both questions together. Did you know that Starbucks was going to be your tenant there? I mean, did you have an idea of what would be in that little space? And what gave you the idea for the little echoing the mini amphitheater where you stand there and your voice is thrown.
Everybody hear that in the back? Okay. Was that a yes or a no? Okay.
So, yes, the answer is yes and maybe and no. The idea of food service was proposed by the design team. You need to have as much life in the space as possible. So let's have a food service. So we had, it was a really well-known deli at one time. I can't remember the name of them. But they were there, and they were not very successful because there were rats everywhere, and it was just a, but you know, it was a positive food service that people recognized as a great place to go and have a cup of coffee. Well, it, by the way, Starbucks didn't exist at this point in time. So there was the next one that failed, and then Starbucks came along. And Starbucks, when I was on the board of directors of Pioneer Square, I learned something about Starbucks. And that is that when Gordon Sondland was on the board at the same time, we were negotiating as part of the facilities committee, which Harriet is still plodding away to keep the faith on the square facilities of the square, which includes major restoration going on right now. But Gordon said, "Doug, just let me." I was saying, making a point, and he said, "Just let me deal with this." And so he said, "Well, what do you want?" And Doug, what do you want? And because I said, "Well, I want to fix that upper terrace that Will and I always argued about, and he won, and I didn't get it my way, and he got it his way, and I'm going to now get it my way." Because I think we can show the Starbucks that you get more seats, and we determined how many more seats, and so there were several other points being made. But the point is that after the meeting, he says, "Doug, what you have to understand is that this is a very successful financial business. You see it as a coffee shop." As a businessman, I see it as a very model for a success. And so, you know, get what you can from them because they have the resources to do it. So we got the, we moved at that point in time, gory details, we got that terrace leveled out. We opened up the water feature that used to block off the upper square to that space, and now you can move in and out of there. Next time you're in a square, take a look at that. That used to be closed off, making that a very, very isolated space, and now it's a much more useful space. So I learned something about
that. Here's a question. Would you ever want to see the Pioneer Courthouse Square on the historic register?
On the register?
Because that's interesting, you know, I mean, making those little design tweaks and changes and things to kind of make it better. Do you think it's as good as it needs to be? Or do you think it's sort of like it's needs to always maybe be able to be changed a little?
Oh, I think it needs to be able to be changed. So to the extent, if you put it on the register, you sort of lock it down. There are things that I think need to be done that I know couldn't afford to be done as part of the improvement that are going on right now that are being studied. Opening up, making the relationship of the square, the major body of the square, to Morrison Street more permeable. something I would like to see, and whether or not that would be allowed if we were a historic landmark, I don't know.
I doubt it.
So I think we have to just keep the faith and understand that we have really good management, we have really good people running the place, we'll always have a good facilities committee because it attracts really good people. And so there's always going to be people, well, like you're on the board now, and Phil Kalber is here.
Holding it back.
A number of other people are here from the board, and you know, these people are very responsible about keeping their eye on the prize. But these things cost money, and so we can't afford to do some of these things now. I'd like to see that they're not big.
Yeah.
They're not
yeah.
big deals. They're,
yeah.
they're little moves. But there are some moves that need to be made.
So I want to wind down just a little bit here because we need to get over and have some drinks. Thought I'd share a couple more old photos.
Where'd you get those?
It's all a big plot. I mean, you're a central...
I painted those white walls on that.
Did you really?
That's house paint.
That's house paint?
That's white house paint that I
wow.
got out of the shop.
Boy, that's country uptown if I've never heard it. That's amazing.
I love my Jeep.
When did you know that you wanted to be a landscape architect?
I didn't even know that landscape architecture existed. I went off to college, wanted to be an architect. So where do you go? Go to Oregon State to become an architect?
Wow. You missed the fork in the road there, huh?
Well, so I went to the orientation, and a guy, I knew I was probably not capable of being an architect because, as somebody said, you got to know all that math, and you got to do your, you got the physics, all that math stuff. And I was terrible at that. I was a terrible student. So, but I stayed around, and there was a landscape architect that was there. And so he put into perspective the difference between an architect and a landscape architect and talked about how they were similar and how they were different. And one of the important things he said is that the good news is they're really basically the same in terms of the objectives of the profession and what you get involved in. And, of course, this was the view of architecture in 64. But he said the right word. He said, with landscape architecture, you don't have to worry about the math. So I followed that guy. And so I stayed at Oregon State and I took the landscape program and realized that I didn't want anything to do necessarily with the horticultural side of it, even though I care about that. That's not my primary interest. So I went through the program and succeeded at landscape architecture at Oregon State until it sort of there's no more design to work to do, but it was all about the plants from then on out. And so I said, well, it's time for me to move on. So I went to University of Oregon to go to an accredited school.
Right.
So
yeah,
that's
yeah.
how I transferred to that.
So another thing about your
Lillian.
Career is that you are an addictive art collector. If you've ever been to his place,
that's where my money goes.
Absolutely incredible. But you have such a deep relationship with Native American art, and you went to school with Lillian, correct?
Yeah, Lillian yeah. and I were classmates.
Who's in the audience, by the way, tonight. How has that influenced you, that relationship, particularly with Native American art? in terms of your design. Also with Rick Bartow, the late Rick Bartow.
Hmm?
Also with the late Rick Bartow?
Oh, yeah.
Would you say that there's an element of those relationships and that urge to collect has influenced your work?
I was raised in on a cattle operation. It's basically a farm, and we were what's called a ranch because we had a much broader leasing program, and we ran cattle on public land and everything, so we were ranchers. That's the distinction between somebody who just farms and somebody who has a lot of animals. So, but the important thing is that Wasco, Paiute, and Warm Springs.
Yeah.
Lillian, do I have this right?
Yes, you have it right.
Thanks. Because I also work with other tribes, and so they're confederated tribes, and then so, yes. So, great people, and I played sports with them, and I used to date a native girl, and my brother Greg is here. He played basketball on the state basketball team with native folks, and just found those relationships and that in that landscape to be kind of their it's their place first. We came later, and I always thought about being sort of secondary to the native people because I, you know, having seen Celilo go down. Which is Celilo Falls was one of the most unbelievable cultural landscapes. And I call it cultural landscape because it was not only a fantastic landscape, but 7 or 8 miles of waterfall, huge waterfalls. That was the basis for native commerce and sustenance. And it was also because it was such an important major fishing grounds. People came from other tribes came from all over the place. So those things had a very strong impact on my attitude about the landscape and culture. I really never thought, and you know, being raised on kind of in the West, being out all day in various forms, working the land, working with animals, taking care of living things, growing things, all became part of that soup that I think led me to say, there's something going on here. I mean, I was obviously not set out to be a farmer. I couldn't, they wouldn't hardly let me drive a tractor because I was so dreamy that I couldn't stay on track because I was watching the coyote off here to the side, so. As it relates to Rick, the late Rick Bartow, who just passed in April, Joe Feddersen, another guy I collect. These are some of the folks that I came to know that were in the arts along with Lillian, and so I became, along with Southwest Native and Native art, I do both jewelry, but mainly textiles, old historic textiles that go way back to, I think you see the child's blanket on the wall, which goes back to, I don't know, 18, I have records on it somewhere, but it's 1860s. Those are things that just resonate with me.
So this deep integration with the land, I've always wondered, I mean, ever since I arrived here and saw your first work, I was always struck by circles. You use circles a lot. There's the Vietnam Memorial, which is more of a spiral, the Nancy Russell Overlook. This is a recurring theme, and I thought it might have something to do with your relationship with Native American art. I now realize it's actually about painting the white walls on the tires of the Jeep.
it's about house paint, yeah. No, there is a relationship. There's the spirit circle, the form of the teepee, the hogan. All of those are landscape and structural forms from the Native American culture that have clearly had an effect. There's sort of, I think, because of a lot of the work that I do, including the Nancy Russell Overlook, which is essentially a memorial to the late Nancy Russell, who basically saved the gorge. I mean, this woman was absolutely the person that saved Columbia River Gorge. This softness and sort of embracing form works very well in terms of many of the things that I've done. Not everything. I mean, I have work that's just quite different. But mm-hmm. But that you're right. That is, I get asked that a lot.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I give a similar answer.
Well, most prominently Pioneer Courthouse Square. So.
Yeah. You know, and that was a collaboration. Will had that was an idea that Will and I had together. I was again the thing I love about my work is that there's all the people that I've worked with over some of the projects that we've shown tonight. I think mainly the stuff that you've shown. The architects, they're collaborations with architects here in this room, and that collaboration is really what the practice is about today, and it's what makes it continue to be interesting to me. I mean, I'm working on projects in Central Washington and Bellevue and Southern California, the Bay Area, all of which are done in collaboration. And to me, that's what makes life interesting.
Well, on that note, thank you for your collaborations with this city and with so many people in it.
Oh. Good turnout. Yeah.
It's a party.
Yeah.
Let's go across the street.
Let's do it.
Please join us across the street at OHS for a bite and a glass of wine. Hope to see you all there.